everyone that's a member of our family and this entire South Florida and Caribbean community. The Word of God says in Revelation, the 21st chapter, verses 3 and 4, it says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There'll be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. The old order of things have passed away." Isn't that good to know this morning? And many of you may be wondering, but what in the world does the life of this amazing young lady of me have to do with the church or with Christ? Why would she have a crown placed on her casket? Why would she be referred to as this, the queen of Soka? Why would she be seen as this amazing woman? What could Soka have to do with Christianity? It has so much to do with us. As you know, in the 17th century, in the 1600s, as slaves were brought over from West Africa, in particular from Nigeria, they brought over this form of music called Guyana. And when it came to this new world, to this Caribbean, to Venezuela, Trinidad, and to St. Vincent and the Grenadines and Jamaica and all over the Caribbean, the slaves, when they came, they understood what the traditional songs they used to sing meant. There were songs of good news back in West Africa. And so when it came here to the new world, these songs morphed, not only from their African heritage, but to encompass their Indian heritage. And so it changed from being calypso to becoming what's known as soca. Calypso meaning the good news. The good news, despite what's happening in our lives, despite what's happening around us, despite all the sad things that are occurring, calypso brought the good news. But then the young people morphed it yet again and brought us this thing called soca, the soul of calypso. If calypso was the good news, then soca is the epitome of good news. And I believe that's why we're here today, to share with this amazing young lady the good news, not of calypso, not of Guyana, not of only her West African heritage, but the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let us pray together this morning. Gracious and most heavenly Father, we come before you. We give you the honor, the praise, and the glory. We thank you for the good news that you sent through your Son, Jesus the Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, on the cross. This great aphrodisiac man that came from heaven on a march, very much like the road march that we do in Soka. But he came on an even longer road march here to earth, so that he could provide for each and every one of us, and for me, for this dearly beloved young lady, hope and a future. That hope and a future is available to each and every one of us today, everyone within the sound of my voice. I ask your God that you would pour out your peace, your compassion, your grace on all who are assembled here today. That you would give them hope for a bright tomorrow, that they will understand that this, Lord, is not the end, but only the beginning of a new and great beginning of good news. Amen and amen. And so, in every good road march, you need a number of good performers. Is that right, Marlon? He said, Marlon understands something about music, and me understood something about music. You need a number of good performers. In fact, one of the greatest performers that we have is Melanie Amaro, right? You may remember Melanie, because she was the first winner of the X Factor, right? She's a millionaire among us, right? But more important than being a billionaire, she's a millionaire for Christ. Won't you put your hands together as we continue the celebration of Miya's life, as we welcome
Praise the Lord. For the Lord is good and his mercies endures forever. I am Reverend Toy Barbell from St. Thomas, United States, Virgin Islands, Mia's cousin. We know that it is a sad state of affairs, but God is our refuge and our strength, and he will give us peace in the midst of the storm. None of us know the day nor the hour when our time shall come. But she was taken too short from us. And therefore, her life, her living was not in vain. So we're going to stand in faith, believing that justice will be served for our beloved Mia. The reading of the Word of God, Psalms 100. Praise the Lord. A psalm for giving thanks. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord in gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and that we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, truly he is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Here ends the reading of the Word of God. Thanks be to God. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you. Boy, now I feel as if I'm in church. Thank you so very much.
interesting, a part of the morphing of this whole notion of Calypso and ska is having a griot, a storyteller, who would tell the good news. Well, one of the best storytellers of the good news, Iman and Marlon, is the next voice that we're going to hear from. You may know him from St. Vincent and the Grenadines, but I know him because I don't know if I should say this in front of my lead pastor, but it's from all the road marches that I went on. And he's a five-time Soca Monarch winner. Ladies and gentlemen, except for the family, could you stand to your feet and give a thunderous round of applause as none other than Gamal Doyle, the man known as Skinny Fabulous, comes to give us a sound of the
best way I know to contribute, in the way that I am comfortable, and the way that I know that Mia would definitely appreciate it, because she was of a Caribbean culture, she was of a soca culture, she was a musical baby, she was a musical princess. Alright.
I'm doing from the yard, but I'm telling you, we will celebrate your name. I feel it. I wanna be caught your picture, I feel it. I love the picture, this picture, I feel it. I wanna be caught your father, I feel it. So how could this be that this perfect human being is not here? She's not here, but I swear that you will never be forgotten. Never be forgotten. You will never be forgotten. And it's so messed up that it's happened, but we can't give up the battle, can't give up the battle. I swear, we've been shining the day, yeah, yeah. And we won't bring the day, yeah, yeah. Life will never be the same, yeah, yeah. But until we meet again, we will celebrate the day, yeah. So we will be, and do it for me, yeah, we will be. And love, I know it from me, I will name. And love, I know it from me, I'm telling it again. We will celebrate today. How can I, how can you, how can we bear this pain? But I know, yes I know, that heaven just gave an angel. Heaven gave an angel.
Thank you.
But at this time, while we wait
for the fit to carry on done, and for lyrical to get here, what we're going to do is I'm going to progress along and look at the video montage that was created. Nothing can capture her life. Do you believe that? In those short years that she's been here, nothing at all can actually capture everything that she's done, everything she's accomplished, all the good that she's done in the world. But we'll ask if you would turn your attention with us to the screen as we take a look at what it is that the family has put together and the friends have put together in terms of describing Miya's life for us in pictures.
Thank you.
overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. In looking at the video tribute to Miya, the one word that kept coming in my mind was priceless. Priceless. In Spanish, when in church, people would say, Dios bendiga, God is good. But God is also priceless. You would say, no tiene precio. There's no price that can be put on the love of Christ. Mirror, mirror on the wall, pointing out your flaws. That isn't who you are. If you could see what I see, that isn't who you are. There's more to who you are. I see you dressed in white, every wrong made right. I see your rose in bloom at the sight of you, oh so priceless, irreplaceable, incomparable. We can start again and give honor to the end. In the pain, you can be brave. Today, part of what helps us to be brave as Christians is understanding our relationship to Christ. And a part of that celebratory move for Christ is in song and in singing. And so at this time, we're going to continue the celebration of Miya's life by calling upon a singer. I know he'll remember that he's in church, and because the fit can't over, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together and give a thunderous welcome to Miracle!
Miya Marcano was an angel on earth and was an angel in heaven. And we shall celebrate and she will party in heaven as he passed the sea. So if you have the music, let's do it one time. Yeah, this was actually one of her favorite songs. Oh Lord, you're high. Excuse my voice. Celebrate tonight. She know the limit is the sky. And she know not, rest in peace. That's why she living for tonight. That's why she living for tonight. She live like the all good end tonight. That's why she living for tonight. Party in the heavens. You might think she's stumbling, but what she has been pumping, she must wind up on something. If the vibes in on the ceiling, exactly how she feeling, and she don't care who watch it. Why? Because she don't hide already. We are living for tonight. She live like it all good end tonight. She living for tonight. Party in heavens. Every single season. This is the perfect reason. She living so she better. Sweat out what she bleeding. Inside she made it shrieking. She don't care who. We love you. Because you don't hide already. Beautiful fly already. You're up in the sky already. Oh Lord, you're high. Celebrating life for when you wake up in the morning. And if you think I'm busy, she can't believe the future. Living for tonight.
Appreciate it.
Lyrical, thank you so very much. I know we're in the midst of a pandemic and you're supposed to keep washing your hand, but after I touch Lyrical hand, I can't wash my hand. Isn't Miya priceless? Isn't she amazing? Isn't she amazing? Put your hands together. I don't know about you, but doesn't it seem strange that someone so young could be so influential that she has brought together an eclectic group of musicians from all over the world, from diverse backgrounds, to come to pay tribute and honor to her at her homegoing service? It must mean that there was something that God had for this little young lady that far exceeded her years, that far exceeded the dreams and the hopes and the aspirations that her parents had for her. Put your hands together for God having allowed us to share the earth with her for the time that she was here. One of the things about homegoing services and celebration is this notion of going forward. And I told you at the beginning of the service that this calypso tradition, this soca tradition, dates all the way back to West Africa, to the Igbo people of Nigeria. And the word that it was originally called, ka and iso, is actually two words. Ka meaning to go, and iso meaning forward. It means to go forward. So when you're marching and you're dancing soca, you're moving forward. And one of the most important and critical things at a homegoing service that is cathartic for the family, that's cathartic for her parents, that's cathartic for every member of her family and her close friends, is what's known as the eulogy. It's this memorializing of the life, not just in song, not just in video and in pictures, but memorializing it in words. That is the essence of moving forward, going forward. Ka iso, soka. So at this time, we call upon Mark Marcano as to do a job that only he can do in remembering Kaylee, okay? That only Kaylee can do. Apparently, I thought Mark was able to do it, but Mark said, no, let Kaylee do this. So, Kaylee, if you could put your hands together as Kaylee comes to eulogize me. Thank you, Kaylee.
Today we are here to honor, celebrate, and remember the life of Miya Iman Yele Marcano, born on April 26, 2002 at 1:24 p.m. in Memorial West Hospital in Pembroke Pines, to parents Marla Marcano and Ima Scarbrio. Miya was a baby sister to Marlon Munchie Marcano Jr. She was a beautiful baby with bright gray green eyes, very calm and quiet, especially once her pacifier and blanket were with her. This stayed about the same throughout her life. Her Bobo and Pooh were later replaced with Phil the Bear's Mopplesun and Sonico, and later with Ted. Miya started school at Palm Cove Elementary and then relocated to the British Virgin Islands, where she attended After moving from Tortola to St. Croix, Miya started at the Alfredo Andrews Elementary School. She then moved back to South Florida, where she attended Pines Middle, Driftwood Middle, and then moved on to Flanagan High School, where she graduated in 2020 in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. Shortly after, Mia's dreams came true when she was accepted to her dream university, the University of Central Florida, where she completed a few semesters before transferring to Valencia to continue her education in sports medicine. From early on, Miya became a Jane of all trades. After taking interest in modeling, pageantry, cheerleading, dancing, horseback riding, and so much more, Miya excelled in everything she set her mind to do, going on to win numerous pageants, cheerleading events, and junior queen of the band for several years. No matter what it was, Miya put her all into everything she did. She took joy in entertaining a crowd. When Miya got back from her trip to Dubai, I was not surprised to hear what she was about her performing as a snap while on board. If I remember correctly, she told me I was so scared that I killed it before showing me clips from that night. Mia's facial expressions, body language, and magnetic energy pulled people in with ease. While Miya was a little shy on a regular day, when it was showtime, she transformed into a whole new person. All the shyness and fear disappeared, and she opened up into a vibrant butterfly that she was. From an early age, Miya was well-traveled. Most of her time was divided between South Florida and the U.S. and British Virgin Islands, but Miya had the opportunity to visit many other places throughout her life. Traveling quickly became a passion of hers. She loved it. Being able to dress up and experience new things truly brought joy to her life. Some of the many countries that were touched by Mia's life are Dubai, the Bahamas, Canada, Trinidad, Mexico, and numerous others. She was the most caring person ever. Her love and kindness were infused in everything she did. She showed this through her decisions to study nursing before changing to sports medicine. Whether it was taking care of our many little cousins or caring for her grandparents and mine, Miya wanted to help whoever she could in any way that she could. When Miya was up at UCF, I would often send her updates on my grandpa before he passed. Her response was always, "I wish I was there so I could help care for him." This represented Miya. Miya could light up any room. She had a magical way of bringing joy every time she walked into the room. No one who met her could forget her smile. She had a lasting impression on everyone she met. Her laugh warmed a room and brought life to the most boring daily activities. It was infectious. I can't count the amount of times that my mom busted in my room late at night to tell us to be quiet or go to sleep. When on vacations, our own room was always a must because no one wanted to deal with the endless giggles. No matter who you were or where you came from, once getting to know her, you had no choice but to love her. She loved spending time with family, especially with her grandma, because she was always down to record whatever foolishness Miya wanted to. She kept us all young. Whether it was new music or a TikTok trend, Miya made sure we were all up to date. Miya was strong, independent, and beautiful. She was bright, and that will never be changed. Miya and her memories will live on with us forever in our hearts. Miya continued to shine her light on us, bring light into our lives in the time that we need you the most. We love you forever. And on behalf of my family, I would like to thank everyone for being here today, and as well as all of the many search parties near and far, those who posted, called, sent flowers, food, the Delta family, the athletes in Trinidad, and the worldwide people who adopted our Miya as their own. Thank you.
Thank you. What a tremendous eulogy. Put your hands together again. One of the exciting things about Miya and her life is the fact that we here at Cooper City Church of God, where our senior pastors, Pastor Victor Massey, is seated to my left, we had the opportunity to share and to fellowship with her grandfather, Horace, here at Cooper City for so many years. Not only is Horace an interesting character who always has a funny word, it's probably where Miya got her wit from, but he's an ordained Episcopal priest. But he's been here at Cooper City Church of God, go figure, right? A Pentecostal church, Episcopal priest, serving faithfully as an usher for years, providing food for the least fortunate members of our church, and to this South Florida community, all without ever seeking any recognition or without asking for anyone to say anything good about him. So it's indeed an honor and a pleasure for Cooper City Church of God and our executive pastor, the Reverend Dr. Clyde Bailey, to come at this time and to deliver a word of encouragement to the family, for a family that goes so far back with this church, Cooper City Church of God. And so at this time, we would ask if you could stand, not in honor of this man of God, but in honor of the God whom he serves. And if you could put your hands together and welcome the Reverend Dr. Clyde Bailey as he comes to give a word of encouragement to the parents at this time. Hear ye him, and be blessed.
Today we gather in this place to celebrate the vibrant short life of Miya. That is the right thing to do. She was spunky. She was vivacious. She was full of life. She epitomized sunshine. Miya wore her Trinidadian tradition honorably. Speaking about Trinidad, that beautiful island in South Caribbean, known as the land of the hummingbirds. I bet you many of you have never stopped to think about that little bird. That little bird which has been recorded to fly as fast as 61 miles per hour. That little bird in the Trinidadian culture says two things. One, if an hummingbird visits you, then it means good luck. If a hummingbird perches on you, it brings good news. Good news in the time of trouble. 19 years ago when Miya was born, Miya brought good news. She was the hummingbird of her family. And so today, as we celebrate her, we think of her and the impact that she has had, not just on her family, but the world at large. But while we celebrate her, there are some people in this auditorium, her parents, her brother, and other members of her family, who mourn deeply her passing. Because you see, this 19-year-old hummingbird no longer flutters her wings. They no longer hear her beautiful voice. And I would invite you to indulge me for a moment. If I could speak to the family. And I'm not going to speak as a hummingbird, but I bring you a message from the creator of the hummingbird. Let us cut through the chase. We don't need any introduction. We don't need any small talk. You have been going about your business, the business of life. You've been living, laughing, loving, enjoying life. And then one day, out of nowhere, unexpectedly, unannounced, this family got the worst news. And what did that do? It meant that they turned the corner of a journey that they were on, a journey with this beautiful young lady, and suddenly, this corner plunged them into a dark abyss, into a place of loneliness and pain, into a place of inexplicable grief and mourning. We call that the valley of the shadow of death. No one expected it. No one predicted it. In fact, no one in this family had any plans that they were ever going to enter into such a dark place. You see, because for this family, they were about the business of enjoying life. They knew that this beautiful young lady was on a path of success. She was pursuing her life's dream. And they dreamt with her. They had aspirations and hope for her. They were looking forward to a bright future where this young lady would continue to achieve great things and they would celebrate. celebrate with her, but in a moment, this family was plunged into the valley of the shadow of death. That valley is a dark and dismal place. So dark and dismal that these family members will tell you that nobody, absolutely nobody, understands what they feel. No one can say enough words of comfort to cheer them, to lift their spirits. Every day, they barely make it from hour to hour. Every day is filled with pain and agony and sorrow and longing for Miya to return. But somehow they realize that she is not coming back. And oh, how the tears flow. Oh, how the grief takes a hold of each heart. And as they grieve, they feel a sense of hopelessness, a sense of loss. How can they go on? How can they continue without their beautiful meal? But somehow, as you guys go through the valley of the shadow of death, there is something that gives you a weird feeling. That although you are alone, you sense something while you're going through this treacherous valley, this deep and dark valley. And what is it that you sense? You simply can't put your finger on it. But every now and then, you sense as if you are not alone. Every now and then, you have this eerie feeling that somebody is there with you, but the valley is too dark. It is too painful. They are consumed with their grief and their mourning, and they can't simply concentrate. But in the depths of the valley, in the midst of your sorrow and pain, you hear a voice, a still small voice, whispering in your ears, "Do not be afraid. I am with you." And you look around. You look around because certainly there is no one else in this valley. I am the only person in this valley. But as you think about those things, you hear the voice come back to you. "Do not be afraid. I am with you." And as you begin to focus on the voice, it occurs to you that it's not your imagination. That somehow, in between the tears, in between the cries, in between the sorrow, you can see barely a figure in front of you. And as you look closely, what do you see? You see a man with a rod and a staff. Well, you don't understand what I'm saying. In the valley of the shadow of death, there comes a man with a rod and a staff. And that man whispers to you, "Do not be afraid, for I am with you." As you look more closely, as you listen more intently, you sense in a moment when you think you're about to give up that the man stretches out his rod and pulls you back. And as he pulls you closer and closer to himself. And he throws his big arms around you and he says, "I..." There's something strange about a valley. A valley has two main points. There is a beginning or an entrance, and there is an exit. Nobody volunteers to enter into this valley. But you found yourself one day in the valley, and as you're going through the valley, as you go across the treacherous floor of this valley, this rocky terrain, it occurs to you that this man drives you tears. As those moments pass and you feel that you cannot make it, he whispers words of comfort into your ear. The other piece about the valley is that it has an exit. Somehow, as you go through the valley of the shadow of death, the exit seems so far away. The exit seems as if it would never come. The exit seems as if you would never reach it. But my friend, because the man with the rod and the staff is with you, because he is there to comfort you and to guide you, he is leading you towards the exit. And you get to the exit of the valley. And you look ahead of you. And somehow the tears stop flowing. And you see ahead of you a table. Not just any old table, but a table filled with the absolutely best things in life. That somehow you see in front of you a table filled with joy and love and peace and happiness and delight and contentment. And the man with the rod and staff, he says to you, this is all yours. This is all yours that I have prepared for you. And then when you look to the side of the table, you see that there are additional things called grace and grace and more blessings. And as you sit down at the table, as you begin to engage in what is at the table, as you begin to consume what the man has prepared for you, he comes beside you and he says to you, this is not all. This is not all. He says, I love you so much that my preparation for you does not end here. He says, I would like to tell you something. From this day onward, I will provide you with 100% 24/7 round-the-clock protection. He says, I'm going to give you a 2 bodyguards. One is called goodness, and one is called mercy. These bodyguards will be with you for the rest of your life. You may never be able to see them with your natural eyes, but trust me, I have assigned them to be with you all the days. You might be wondering, what am I talking about? You might be there thinking, oh, the preacher has snatched a story from Disneyland there in Orlando. No, my friend, every word that I have said to you is true. That while you are going through this dark, dismal period of your life, there is a man. There is a man who presents himself with a rod and a staff, and he is making himself available to comfort. He is saying to you, you do not need to go through this alone. And you might be wondering, how can I meet this man? How can I experience life with the man with the rod and the staff? As you could guess by now, I'm speaking from the 21st Psalm. And the answer to the question lies in the opening line of that psalm. If you want to experience the comfort and the company that the man with the rod and staff gives, look at the first line. It says, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And today, that man is here. Today, that man is standing right beside you. Today, that man is right next to you. And he said to you, if you make that decision,
be the source of comfort during this time of grief. I will be with you so that you will never, ever walk alone. Friends, there is something I believe that Mia would want me to say to you. Because of the grief that her passing has left you with, she would not want you to grieve forever. She would not want you to grieve alone. And so if I could one moment borrow the myth of the hummingbird, I'm here to give you good news. Good news that Jesus is waiting for you to invite you into your life. I'm going to ask to stop just for a few seconds and think about it. Every one of us in this room is mourning her passing, some more than others. Everyone is sorrowful that this life has been cut short way too soon. But I'm saying to you, you don't have to grieve alone. Jesus is making himself available to be the shepherd in your life. Could I ask you all to bow your heads? And even as you contemplate what I have been saying, even as you contemplate the reality that there is a man with a rod and staff, his name is Jesus, even as you try to decide, should I accept that man in my life? Should I give him the opportunity to walk with me, to talk with me, to comfort me, to guide me? Should I do that? Or will you do the foolish thing and walk out of these doors and say to the man with the rod in the staff, I do not need you in my life. I can make it on my own. I suspect that you would want to do the wise thing. And so while your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'll say one line and you say, you repeat it after me, until we come to the end of that prayer. And in that prayer, if you are sincere, if you genuinely want the man with the rod and the staff to come into your life and to lead you and to guide you and to provide you with the comfort that you need even at this critical moment, then you can say it. But if you're not interested, don't say it. Everybody together. Dear God, thank you for the life of Mia. Thank you that in your wisdom you blessed us with her. And now you have taken her and left us with pain. But today we hear your voice. Today we hear your message. That you are right here to ease our pain, to dry our tears, to take away our sorrow. Jesus, in this moment, I sincerely ask you to become my shepherd, to become my friend, to walk with me, to comfort me, to dry my tears, to be my very best friend. Thank you, Jesus, for hearing my prayer. Amen. 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 Friends, if you pray,
pray that prayer. Family, friends, guests, whoever you are, if you pray that prayer and you sincerely meant every word, believe me, I can say this without fear of contradiction, that you now have a new friend. And his name is Jesus. God bless you.
And the 15th verse says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. And it's not just talking about the pretty expensive shoes that Dr. Bailey is wearing. It's talking about the feet of a person, the thing that's most important. And in soap, as you know, maybe when you're doing a road march, you might be focused on the skimpy outfits. But the feet are really what's important, right? It's really about the foot movement. And so maybe this may have been your first time coming out to the house of the Lord and to hear Dr. Bailey preach this word of God and encouragement to the family. But it's the same thing that Ben Jai talks about when he talks about becoming a soap of Bible. He said, Dr. Bailey is talking to you about becoming a soap of Bible, becoming a survivor by coming to know the Savior. Amen? Put your hands together again for the man of God. Now, it's interesting, we've heard from so many interesting and important people. But the next voice that you're going to hear of, he probably doesn't watch The X Factor, but I'm not certain about that. He probably has never listened or been one of the tens of thousands of people who watch Skinny Fabulous or listen to him. He's probably never done a road march with Lyrical. He's never marched in Ring Road in Jamaica or marched in Calypso in Trinidad and Tobago, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, or in the U.S. Virgin Islands. He probably has never worn a crown like me. But the important thing about him is that he knows someone who wears the ultimate crown. He knows the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the ultimate road march warrior. And so I'm deeply humbled today to bring you a man who may never have sung a calypso tune or spurted out anything to do with soca, but he's a man who knows God. And so I'm deeply humbled today to invite to the podium at this time someone who is going to speak and to say a prayer over the lives of Mia's family, over Mimi's family, and over your lives as well, to give you comfort and to give you peace. Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to present to some and to introduce to others the lead pastor of the Cooper City Church of God, a humble man of God who loves people and loves the family of Miya Marcano, and wants to come at this time to pray a final prayer, a homegoing prayer, a prayer of comfort and peace. Won't you put your hands together as the Reverend Pastor takes a massive comfort.
I've never done all of those things, but all I need is an invitation. I want to just confirm what Pastor Clyde Bailey has just spoken to us. 2 days after I asked for my wife's father's blessing to marry her, 2 days after that event, his life was taken from him for no apparent reason. Murdered at the hands couple of young men there in Pensacola, Florida. About this time last year, my wife's sister suffered a brutal death that is still being investigated as a homicide. So what Pastor Clyde Bailey just spoke to you, I'm here to confirm that without the Lord as our shepherd, we would never make it through the valley or the shadow, the valley of the shadow of death. It is He who comforts us and strengthens us and helps us to get through those moments in our lives. Ema, Marlon, as the lead pastor of this church and speaking for this congregation, thank you for trusting us to host this event, to host this celebration of life for your beautiful daughter. And I would also say thank you to the two of you for giving us such a beautiful light to this world. I didn't know Mia, but just looking at these pictures, when I see her eyes, I see life. And when I see her smile, I see joy. So thank you for giving that gift to us. And it's evident that in the 19 short years that she was here on this earth, that she impacted many lives. I have assisted in officiating many of these kinds of services. But Ema and Marlon, I have never seen this kind of a response. So what an impact she has made on people's lives that has literally touched the world. But I just want the two of you to know today that that's not the only reason why we have all gathered here. Yes, we've gathered here because the impact that this young lady has left upon all of us, but we have also gathered here today because we love the two of you. And our attendance here today, sometimes we don't know what to say. Times like this. But I just pray that our presence today speaks volumes to the both of you, that we want you to know that you don't have to walk through this alone. Not only is the shepherd walking through this valley with you, but look around this room at all of these ladies and gentlemen who are here to say to you today, we're walking with you. And we're praying that the Holy Spirit would use us to be a source of comfort and encouragement and strength to all of you. And we want you to know that it's not just our presence here today, but that in the days to come, and in the weeks to come, and in the months to come, we're here for you, for whatever you need. Would you all bow your heads with me this morning as we pray? Father God, our hearts are grieving with this family who is hurting. This family who has suffered such great tragedy at the hands of evil. We ask that you would be their comforter, that you would cover them with your grace and mercy, surrounding them with your peace during this dark time. We thank you that you alone are our refuge, our strong tower, our defender, and our peace. We thank you that no matter what we face, you are still on the throne. You are still in control. And that no evil can ever stand against you. It will be defeated. It will not win. For you alone, Lord Jesus, have won the final victory, and the enemy's days are numbered. We ask that by your mighty power, you would bring down the forces of darkness, that you would thwart the plans of all those who plot to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That you would draw out of darkness those souls who need to know you as Savior and Lord. We know that only in you do we have the hope to face dark and uncertain times. For our future is secure only through the sacrifice of Christ. Thank you, God, that you are surely with us. Thank you that you care. Thank you that your presence is close and that you weep with those who weep. We need you. We know and believe beyond any doubt that your power and love will never fail. Now I invite all of you to pray with me the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. In the mighty name of Jesus, the name above all names, we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you so very much, Pastor Massey. We appreciate you. Wasn't it good to be in the house of God today? Yes, praise be to God. But there's one last thing. We started out the service with saying it's a service of celebration and honor to Mimi for the life that she's lived. And we started it out with song, and we're going to end it with song. But while the song is being performed, it's being done by Melanie Amaro, right, the X Factor winner. We're going to call on the ushers of the Cooper City Church of God if they would come at this time. Because there are many ways of honoring Mia. We honor her in words, we honor her in song. But how important and how fitting a tribute it would be to honor her by funding her foundation that's going to seek to do a work that so many of you have already begun. Not in just marching for Soka, but more importantly, marching and searching for her during the time that she was missing. A foundation that will be dedicated to doing great work and great things that will continue on long after Mia has been interred. But this contribution that you do today, the seed that you're about to sow today.